we remain two-dimensional, but now we talk about entanglement. Please, Sarah.
Okay. Let me check it. Okay. Hi, everybody. Thank you, the organizers, for giving me the opportunity of presenting what I did in my first month of research. And the goal of this talk is to merge two fields of physics. One is about entanglement, which nowadays is an active field of research, whose relevance goes from high energy physics for the study of black hole physics or in holography, but also in condensed matter systems, because it allows to show what are some universal properties of systems at criticality. And another pillar of modern physics are symmetries. So the goal of this talk is to understand how the presence of a global U1 symmetry in a system influences the behavior of the entanglement. And the results of what I'm going to tell you are collected in this work that I've done with Giuseppe Di Giulio, another PhD student in CISA, and my supervisor Pasquale Calabresa. So let me start with some standard definition. We will consider a bipartition of an Hilbert space into HA times HB, where HA contains the degrees of freedom of A, while HB contains the degrees of freedom of B. Rho is the density matrix of our system that we take to be in a pure quantum state, psi. And if we trace over the degrees of freedom of B, we obtain this object, which is called the reduced density matrix. Now, a measure of entanglement between A and B are the so-called Rényi entropies, which are defined in this way. And the limit n going to 1 is the so-called von Neumann entanglement entropy. Moreover, we will consider a generator of a U1 symmetry, this charge operator Q, that we will consider an additive charge. This means that the total charge of the system will be given by the sum of the charge in the subsystem A and the charge in the subsystem B. And if rho is in a negative state of Q, it will commute with Q. So we have this commutation relation that we can trace over the degrees of freedom of B, and we obtain this other commutation relation. Now, this basically means that rho of A has a block diagonal structure where each block can be labeled by an eigenvalue of the charge operator, this small q. And we want to project our reduced density matrix in each of these blocks in order to define the q moments of the reduced density matrix. And from them, we can define the symmetry resolved Rényi entropies. Now, this definition requires the knowledge of the entanglement spectrum, but also its resolution in the different sectors, which is a very difficult task if one wants to have an analytical result. For this reason, 2 years ago, Selleck Goldstein used the Fourier representation of the projection operator in order to connect the Q moments of the reduced density matrix to this function, which are called the charge moments, which are nothing more than a partition function on an unsheeted Riemann surface with the insertion of a flux. Okay. I should go on. Probably there is a technical problem.
Try maybe clicking in the slide and then, yeah.
Okay, so as I was telling you, we want to compute the partition function on this unsheeted Riemann surface with insertion of a flux, which is such that once the field goes around the entire surface, it will pick up a phase, which is alpha. And we can use some standard techniques in quantum field theory in order to compute this partition function. Basically using, for example, the fact that it can be computed as a two-point function of a twist field, whose role is to implement the boundary condition of the field at the entangling point. And This is a standard technique that one uses in the absence of alpha. Now, in the presence of alpha, we will call this twist field modified twist field, since the boundary condition of the field around this entangling point has to take into account not only the permutational symmetry of the among replicas in our unshielded Riemann surface, but also the presence of the flux. And this two-point correlation function of twist field for a conformal invariant theory is uniquely fixed by the scaling dimension of the twist fields. For free theories we are interested in, we can do a further simplification, the so-called diagonalization in replica space. This means that rather than working on a complicated and sheeted Riemann surface, we can work on a single plane, a complex plane. We can collect the n component of the field in one single vector field with n component. We can write down the transformation matrix for the field across the different replicas. And once we diagonalize this transformation matrix, we end up into n decoupled fields, what I've called here phi tilde, whose boundary condition around the entangling point, as I stressed before, depends on the kth replica and on the presence of this phase alpha. And the two-point correlation function of the twist field will allow us to compute the partition function on the plane. Moreover, also the twist field can be written as the product of an independent twist field. So basically the total partition function is given by the product of an independent partition function. And this is an approach in order to compute the charge moments. Another approach relies on the equivalence between the Green's function on one of these copy and the partition function in the same geometry, which is basically a cut plane. So if we solve this differential equation, we can compute the partition function in each sheet and then the charge moments. In order to do that, one usually introduces these auxiliary quantities from which we can compute the C function, which are the analog of the homologic of C function with the introduction of a flux alpha. And if we integrate it over L, we obtain the logarithm of the charge moments. Okay, so this has been basically the starting point, so the computation of the charge moments, in order to apply the protocol I told you before, that is Fourier transform, and finally computation of the symmetry resolved Reni entropies. And we did it for two free theories. So a massive Dirac field theory, described by this action. We computed the C function, then we used the analytical expression for the C function in the small and large mass limits in order to obtain through a Fourier transform the final expression for the symmetry resolved entropies. And we can see that in both cases, so small and large mass limits, the entanglement entropy satisfies the equipartition at leading order. This means that this term and these first two terms are basically the results for the massless and massive entanglement. And the corrections, which explicitly depend on the charge sector, are subleading with respect to the to these ones. The same result has been found for a free massive complex scalar theory. So this exact equipartition at leading order. And in this case, we were also able to perform the computation for a free massive complex theory across a hyperplane in d dimensions. And we basically found that the dependence on alpha of the charge moments was the same. This means that after the Fourier transform, also the behavior of the symmetry resolved entropy is the same. And so we have found once again the entanglement equipartition. Okay, so let me try to draw some conclusions and sum up what I said in these 10 minutes. So this entanglement equipartition is a characteristics is a characteristic of conformal invariant one-dimensional systems. But I've showed you that also in by adding a mass, this entanglement equipartition is still satisfied. So away from criticality, it also holds in higher dimensional systems, at least for a complex massive scalar theory, and some other possible directions could be what happens in presence of non-abelian symmetries, or what is the behavior of other resolved measures of entanglement, like, I don't know, negativity or something else. And thank you for the attention.
Thank you very much for the nice talk. Are there any questions for Sarah? I might have one, if nobody else has a question. It's related a bit to this very last, almost last point that you were making about non-abelian symmetries, but also to the very beginning. So if you could go to the first slide. Back. Yeah, this one. Right. This thing that you do, the last line where you take the trace on B and you get that rho A and Q A commute, aren't you using that basically Q must be, it must map H A, that Hilbert space, to itself, basically? If Q mixed up H A and H B, you wouldn't be able to.
No, indeed, this is one of the assumptions that we have done, and it is that the charge operator is the sum of the charge operator into the subsystem A and the one into the subsystem A.
Okay, I understand. Now, because, I just wanted to make this comment, because while this is fairly reasonable for a U1 charge, it starts being a little bit less trivial for a non-abelian charge, maybe.
Yes, indeed, for the non-abelian charge, we have tried to do the to study the SU2 case, but we haven't found a very clear result up to now. Okay. The point is that in that case, you should consider the two generators of the SU2 symmetry, so the component of the spin and the total spin. And the tricky point is to understand with respect to one charge one should resolve. So the Z component of the spin, or both the J component of the total spin, or just one of them. Mm-hmm. It's still, we're still working on that.
Okay, thank you very much. Any more questions for Sarah?